Welcome to Northeast Presbyterian Church, to a kind of worship service we have never, ever had. There are four of us in this big, empty sanctuary. Myself, Carrie Roberts, who will be singing, Dr. Ann Wilson on the piano, and Billy Grooms up there in the clouds in our audio-visual booth. We're doing it this way because we want to practice what Jesus called the second greatest commandment, to love your neighbor as yourself. They've canceled the Masters, March Madness, political rallies. We want to do our part to try to mitigate, to try to stop the spread of this horrible COVID-19 coronavirus. And so they tell us to do this, to protect primarily the elderly and those with health problems. When you're watching this, it will be Sunday morning, the Ides of March, March 15, exactly 4 weeks before Easter Sunday. We're recording here on Saturday afternoon. Already the virus has penetrated Kershaw County, Lancaster County, and now Lexington County. And we don't know where all of this will go, but our great God does. And we want to gather to worship Him. As I begin, I want to share for those of you all in our church family, early this morning, the Lord took home to be with Himself one of our dear members who had battled multiple sclerosis for 35 years, Mary Heath Etheridge, husband of Mike Rogers. We'll give details of services when we know them. And then just a personal word, if I may do this. These beautiful flowers that are in front of me that were given by someone in our church in honor of my wife and I. So I don't know that that's ever happened before, but to you, I say thank you so much, as does Kathy. I've fielded many, many questions about, well, what else will be canceled? What will happen this week? And we're going one day at a time, listening to what DHEC says, to what the governor says, to what the medical experts say. We'll send out another formal word on Tuesday. You can go to our website, nepresbyterian.org, nepresbyterian.org, and you can get all the latest information. And then if you're already receiving our midweek email, we'll send additional information that way on Tuesday. And just one other mention, You can give. You who are members can give through the website. There are a number of ways to give, and I would encourage you to do that as part of your worship experience, as part of your walk through the Lord. So staff gets paid, so missionaries get paid, so the electric bill gets paid. Nobody knows how long all of this will last. We're just trying to walk in step with God's Holy Spirit as much as we can, one day at a time. But I'm going to preach today not about this physical virus, maybe about a spiritual virus, I suppose you could say. But we've been preaching on the names Jesus called people in the New Testament, or if I can put it a little bit differently. In the Gospels, there are only five people that it is recorded Jesus called by name. I'm sure He called hundreds of people by name, but in the Gospels, only five are listed. You've heard a message from Pastor Eric Walter about a woman named Martha who was called by name by Jesus. Last Sunday you heard from Pastor Josh Desch about a man named Zacchaeus who was called by name. But today I want to talk with you about what the scripture says about a man named Simon the Pharisee that was called by name. And I'll be teaching from Luke chapter 7. So if you have your Bible at home, you may want to get it out and open it in front of you. I'll be using the English Standard Version, but whatever you have will work, whether it's the NIV or the good old King James or the New King James or whatever. I'm sure they'll all be helpful. Let me just pray. Our Father and our God, we cry out for your touch on our hearts and on our lives. I pray that you would open this word up in such a way that it would nurture the souls of all who are listening by the power of your Holy Spirit. For this I ask in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So I'm going to have 3 points that I would like to present to you that I think are presented in this passage. So the first one is, when life has killed your dream, go to Jesus. In other words, when your life has fallen apart, go to Jesus. Now I want to read to you, beginning in Luke chapter 7, verse 36. One of the Pharisees, and that's a religious leader, one of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. So by virtue of them reclining, you can tell it's at least a semi-formal banquet. They're all leaning on their arms around the food. And so while they're eating, or maybe as they're beginning, or maybe at the end, behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner. Now, whenever in the scriptures they refer to a woman being a sinner, being known as a sinner, they're meaning that sexually she was profligate, maybe a prostitute. This woman had a reputation. Behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner, when she learned that Jesus was reclining at table in the Pharisee's house, so she already knew who he was. I'm guessing she had stood at the edge of the crowd and heard him speak about forgiveness, about redemption, about a clean heart, a new life. Don't know all the details, but she heard that that man with that message, the man she had seen performing all the miracles, was now reclining in the house of Simon the Pharisee. And when she learned that he was reclining at table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment, and standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and wiped them with the hair of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. I try to picture that. I don't think it's a dainty little tear or two. I think she was just sobbing and sobbing, and the floodgates were opened from the deepest part of her heart. And she was covering the Savior's feet with her tears and then putting the ointment on them, this precious ointment, and then drying them with her hair. I think she was a woman who had been broken. A woman who had made decisions in her life that had destroyed her life, sucked the joy out of her life. And now she was freed. A few days ago, I had the pleasure of hearing one of my very favorite songs, I Dreamed a Dream, from Les Miserables. That was a great novel written by Victor Hugo in the middle of the 1800s. In my opinion, one of the greatest novels of forgiveness and redemption that has ever been written. And then in the 1980s, it was made into a magnificent play, starting in Paris and London and then in New York, and now has traveled to so many cities. I've seen it so many times. I've read the novel a couple times, even a few months ago, most recently. But as it turned out, this song I heard came just a week before this message, which had been scheduled a long time ago. And the woman Fantine in Les Mis, she's a beautiful young woman, the kind of woman that whose beauty just gives her a power over men. They're just mesmerized when they see her. And as a result, she allowed that power to be used in such a way that she made decisions that would forever wreck her life, that would forever destroy her dream. And I've asked Carrie Roberts to sing this song, but I want you to listen closely to the words. And especially if you are someone whose dream has been shattered, see if you can identify with these words. And when your dream is sucked away, when it's destroyed, you go to Jesus. But listen to the words.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by, when hope was high and life worth living. I dreamed that love would never die. I dreamed that God would be forgiving. Unafraid, and dreams were made and used and wasted. There was no ransom to be paid, no song unsung, no wine untasted. But the tigers come. As soft as thunder, as they tear your hope apart, as they turn your dream to shame. Took my childhood in his stride, but he was gone when autumn came. And still I dream he'll come to me, that we would live the years together.
Were you able to catch the words of that song? Did you hear how it ended? I had a dream my life would be so different, but now life has killed the dream I dream. Can you relate to that? So many of us can, in one way or another. But guess what? The solution when something like that happens is to go find Jesus. And where is he? The woman found him in the house of Simon the Pharisee. Where do you find him? Where will I find him? Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and dine with that person." And we're not talking about a fast food American meal. We're talking about a long Middle Eastern meal where you talk and you cry and you listen and you're silent and then you speak. Jesus wants to know about your life. He loves you so much. Go find Jesus when your dream collapses. And that's what this woman does. And I think that's why this passage, this story is given to us. But then the second part, the point I think it illustrates is only broken people can really understand true love. Only people that have been chewed up really know what love is. Let me see if I can show you this from the scripture. Verse 39. Now when the Pharisee who had invited Jesus saw that this woman came in and was making do about Jesus' feet with her tears and her ointment, he was sort of aghast that Jesus would permit this. So when he saw this, he said to himself, if this man Jesus were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him. He already had her stigmatized, categorized, that sort of woman. He would have known, for she is a sinner. And Jesus, answering, said to him, Simon, calls him by name, Simon, I have something to say to you. And Simon answered, say it, teacher. So Jesus went on. A certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii. A denarii is a day's wages, let's say $100. One owed 500 denarii, 500 times $100, that's 50,000. And the other owed 50. 50 times 100 is 5,000. So one person owes this moneylender $50,000, and the other owes him $5,000, which they could not pay. So when they could not pay, the moneylender canceled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Jesus asked. Simon answered, the one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt. And Jesus said to him, you have judged rightly. Why do I say only broken people, only chewed up people can really understand love? I've had the privilege of being a pastor for 40 years in a church that has just poured out its love and affection on me and on my family. So gracious. In fact, they even line up on Sundays at the door and tell me what a good sermon it is, whether it is or not. But you know, all of that kind of love, which is real, which is genuine, pales in comparison to the love of one particular woman. You know, I can hide from people in my church, hide behind a pulpit, hide behind a robe, put on my face, my right face, best foot forward when the crowd is around. But no one can do that 24/7. Who you really are shows up at home. And the person in this world that knows my flaws more than anyone else, knows my blemishes, knows my weak points is my wife, Kathy. And yet, I know she loves me unconditionally in spite of all the stuff. And I think it took me a while to really understand that. But as my eyes were opened to the magnitude and the sincerity of that love, it just changed my heart. And I began to understand what love really is. Not just from a human, but from God too. In verse 44, it goes on, then turning towards the woman, Jesus said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. He's saying, Simon, just as you stereotyped and stigmatized that woman, put her in a little box in your mind, you did the same thing to me. You've not bothered, Simon, to look at her heart, to consider who she is as a person, as an individual. Simon, you've not done that with me. You've not tried to figure out who I really am. You've stigmatized both of us. You've made a quick judgment. Your heart is cold, Simon. Your heart is locked up. There's no mercy in your heart. And Simon, your soul is in grave danger. And then Jesus goes on in verse 47. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little. In other words, Simon, she admitted her sins. She knew about her sins. The sins that destroyed her dream and chewed her life up and sucked all the joy and hope out of her life. She acknowledged that and came to me, believing in me, accepting my mercy. But Simon, you're the kind that views yourself as being righteous. You don't think you've done anything wrong. You think you're better than everyone else. You are self-righteous. Jesus is trying to get him to see this. You've never said, I was wrong. I'm sorry. You see, only broken people can know what real love is. Because when you think you're perfect, of course you expect the whole world to love you. Of course you should love me. I'm perfect. But once you acknowledge the flaws and the failures and the inconsistencies and the hypocrisies and the addictions and all the pus that lies in the depths of each of our souls and are then still loved, that's overwhelming. Which brings me to the last point. The third point is, my peace I give to you. First point was, when your dream is destroyed, go find Jesus. And he's always knocking at the door of your heart. And if you open the door, he will come in and make you whole. And then you will understand what real love is, because you will see the Savior loving you in spite of all of your blemishes and glitches. And that will be overwhelming. It will change your heart. And it'll bring you to this last point. In verse 48, Jesus said to the woman, your sins are forgiven. Then those who were at table with him began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? The answer is, it's God, the Lamb of God, who forgives sins. The one who came to seek and to save the lost, as he would say later in Luke. The one who said, it's not the well who need a physician, it is the sick. It's that Savior. He came to save those who would acknowledge their need of the Savior. And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. It wasn't all her tears. They came as a result of her faith. We don't know the exact story. Maybe it's too personal to share. We're not given it. But somehow she heard Jesus, and she knew that through repentance of her sins and asking for forgiveness and believing in Jesus, she would get a new heart, a new life, new joy, new hope. And she would get the kind of peace. My peace I give unto you, said Jesus. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled. Jesus' peace goes with you regardless of the circumstances. It's something that cannot be explained humanly. It's mysterious. It's superhuman. And it's what he offers to you and me. Well, you know who this story is really about? The story of the sinful woman and Simon the Pharisee. Do you know who it's really about? It's about you and me. I am the sinful woman. You are the sinful woman. If we think we're not broken and sinful, then we are Simon the Pharisee, cold-hearted, hard, merciless, thinking we're better than others. Whenever I read this passage, one of my favorite in the whole Bible, I'm always convicted because there's always a part of Simon the Pharisee alive and well in my heart. And when I read this, it just propels me to my knees. And I say, Father, Lord Jesus, I am the sinful woman. Have mercy on me. Forgive my sins. And Jesus says, go and sin no more. As he said to the woman caught in adultery, the episode recorded in John chapter 8. Now see, Jesus can see the heart. You and I cannot. Jesus told us in the Sermon on the Mount, the way you and I can determine what is in a heart is by looking at the fruits of a life, seeing what a person does. And so we are called upon to forgive all of those humans who hurt us, even if they are our enemies, forgive them. But reconciliation cannot really come in a relationship until there is a real understanding that the heart has changed. And so humanly, it takes days, takes months. Sometimes it takes years to know, was that heart truly changed? But that's human to human. With God, we can come to God and say, Father, forgive me. Have mercy upon me. Lord Jesus, I'm beholding you, the Lamb of the world who takes away the sin of the world, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. I believe in you the best I can. Wash me clean. Well, I believe the song Fantine sings in Les Mis just so beautifully pictures the heartbreak of anyone whose life has been shattered, whose dreams have been shattered, particularly so if it was their own foolish decisions. But she ran to Jesus, and he forgave her. He redeemed her. He gave her a new heart, new hope, new joy. He gave her his peace that passes all understanding. And so now Fantine, she was a mythical character, a wonderful one. But the woman in this story, the sinful woman, she's as real as you and I are. And she's in heaven above. And I don't know what they sing now in heaven, but I have to think that they sing some of the songs we sing. And I think the song that she would be singing more than any other is Amazing Grace that saved a wretch like me. So I would like to end this time with you, this strange worship service, by asking Carrie to sing Amazing Grace. I want you to picture the woman whose dream was shattered, who ran to Jesus and was given new hope, new life, because of the amazing grace of God. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through
Will you pray with me? Our Father and our God, we all love that song so much. And it was written by someone so chewed up, so evil, so broken, until he met your grace. Lord Jesus Christ, hear the prayers, hear the cries of everyone who has heard these words of yours to that sinful woman. Father, help that person to run to Jesus. Thank you for the peace that you promised to us. We will be forever singing about that as we meet with you face to face, as we meet with the sinful woman face to face, as hopefully, Father, we meet with a changed and heart-softened Simon the Pharisee face to face. Give strength and encouragement, Father, to those who are broken, to those who are struggling, to those who are battling. Give us protection from this virus. Give us protection from evil, for we belong to you, and we call out to you, our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name I offer this prayer. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.